It's important that our stories be told as honestly as possible, and that they be authentic voices that are speaking from the heart.
Their stories are rooted deep in our nation's history. Hispanic Americans fighting for their dreams.
We have gone unnoticed what we have given to this country.
I was aware of the differences. You know, I was very aware that we were from Mexico and that we were working class.
Change in the workforce, in society, has come with sacrifice.
Pulverized my spleen and I almost died for doing peaceful protests.
We were a controlled people politically, so we changed that. It wasn't easy.
Determination paying off.
I worked two jobs, saved up as much money as I could. We both worked really hard, and we took a risk with very little money.
Hispanic culture thriving, the history educating and influencing future generations.
There's different styles of music. Some of it is very lively, very energetic, very fast. Some of it is really slow, and that all depends on the traditions.
This is KCRA 3 Project Community, celebrating Hispanic heritage.
Thank you so much for joining us. I'm Lisa Gonzalez. No matter where you live, you do not need to look far to see the positive impact of Hispanics and Latinos. From the fight for social justice and expanded worker rights to the influence on music and cuisine, the contributions are everywhere. It was 1968 when the United States first celebrated Hispanic Americans with Hispanic Heritage Week. 20 years later, President Ronald Reagan signed a law celebrating Hispanic heritage for a full month. Right now, more than 60 million Hispanics live in the United States, nearly one-fifth of our population. Their experiences along the journey to the American dream are emotional and inspiring. And you're about to hear three of those stories. Annabelle Albatorio, a veteran of a distinguished military unit that didn't earn proper recognition for decades. Laura Murillo, who was on a mission to reunite her family after fleeing Cuba. And Paul Rojas, a social and political trailblazer, still going strong at 87 years old. Bianca Beltran begins with Paul's story.
His last name, Rojas, is proudly displayed around his home in Kansas City's West Side, but his first name was given to him in school.
My real name is Raul. I guess the nuns took the little foot off the R, made it a Paul, a P. But that was not uncommon.
Paul's father came to the United States from Mexico.
That guy right there is my dad.
The musician found work in packing houses. Paul grew up during World War II.
Real distinctly remember in school when Rita Moreno comes in and she was crying. They had just got notice of her dad. They sunk the ship.
He joined the Navy as a teenager, serving during the Korean War.
You had one son, you had one star. However, my sons were serving, that's how many stars were on your window. There was not a window in this West Side that didn't have one of these, with a number of stars. We have gone unnoticed for what we have given to this country. And all of us, like myself, are very proud to be American citizens.
He became politically active, working to increase Hispanic representation.
We formed a political organization. We, like in the black community, we were a controlled people politically. So we changed that. It wasn't easy. There were threats made.
Rojas was the first Latino elected to the Missouri State House in 1972. While doors opened for change, he received questions.
Some people would ask me, where are you from? You know? In that state capital, where are you from? Where am I supposed to be from, you know? But
despite progress, he says discrimination persists.
There's a movement, an organized movement, to paint us as not worthy of holding such positions because they label us as being non-Americans, this, and being criminal elements. Many of the things that are not true.
At 87 years old, he continues to be involved with the historic Guadalupe Center's organization, providing education and services to the Hispanic community in Kansas City.
This is a systematic, organized land grab movement.
And speaking out against gentrification.
The bulldozer that's going to run me out of here hasn't been built yet.
He says young people give him hope for the future.
Be proud of your heritage and be proud of who you are. And we all made in God's image. plain and simple.
Snapshots of an adorable little girl whose story begins in Cienfuegos, Cuba in 1991.
Now that I think back, I realize how poor we really were, but when I lived there, I didn't realize it, kind of thing, you know what I mean?
When Laura was 14, she came to the U.S., but she had to leave her mom behind.
The language, by far, was the hardest thing, and then, well, obviously being away from my mom.
Laura first lived in Miami, Florida with her dad. He'd fled the island when she was just a little girl. That was back in 1997.
If I don't leave the country, I will never be able to give my family a future.
In 2007, Laura's dad moved the family from Miami to Winston-Salem, North Carolina, and Laura was on a mission.
Okay, she was focused on that, and that was the only thing in her mind.
Once you got here, you made it your life's mission to reconnect with your mom. Right?
Yeah.
So tell me a little bit about that.
Yeah. So before I left, one of the reasons I felt okay leaving was because I had already told my, like, I had this narrative in my mind of, like, this is what I'm doing. Like, there's not any questions, any if or buts. Like, I'm getting there, I'm going to school, and I'm getting my family over there.
Laura's mom still gets emotional when she talks about the time she spent away from her daughter. She says it's an emptiness she just couldn't fill. Years would pass, but then it happened.
Now I'm gonna, like, live my life, and they're gonna be a part of it.
These pictures were taken at Miami International Airport when the family was reunited in 2013.
I felt really proud.
But as it turns out, getting mom here, that was the easy part.
Teaching them everything, like, explain to somebody what credit is and how it works and what a debit card is. And to this day, we'll go to the store and she's like, don't leave me.
Through it all, the family became stronger, closer.
Me just, like, continuing school and not leaving school to do what I did would have been easier, but I don't know that I would do it any different because I wouldn't want them to be, like, right now with this pandemic, the situation in Cuba now is just horrendous. Like, I would be going insane if my mom was still there.
Laura's also a mom now to this little guy, 3-year-old Luca. He was born right here in Winston-Salem, North Carolina. He just woke up from a nap, still groggy from that American dream.
We're not perfect, but we're very blended, and we make it work. So I'm proud of what we've built here.
That picture reminds me because he was a good man.
There are young men sitting in books in retired Command Sergeant Major Anibal Abertorio's house.
Here is the famous 65th Infantry softball team. We were champions. I remember all those, most of them passed away, most of them. I don't recall anybody that's alive except me. The others are gone.
Young when they joined the military at 18, volunteers, shipped off to fight in 1950 to Korea.
Oh, here is the one.
Mr. Abertorio is a member of the famed 65th Infantry Regiment, nicknamed the Boriquaneers, an all Puerto Rican unit who served in America's wars since the First World War, serving at a time when discrimination based off race was the norm.
They forget that we are one nation under God. We want to fight for the same principles. And those bullets don't have any colors or any particular agenda. They are there to shoot you.
At 91 years old, this vet served in Korea and Vietnam. Many of the men who left the island territory with him never made it home.
It's those that were beside me, behind me, in front of me, that didn't return. They stayed there, missing in action, KIA. They never had the opportunity to return. Those things on my mind always haunt me forever. That I could not do something about that particular soldier, my brother, I could not do nothing about it. So that really stay on my mind all the time. You got to love your country. You got to protect your country by your daily behavior. Remember that you are here because so many of them stay behind defending this country.
It's the active service message that keeps Mr. Abertorio hard at work, a job he says he will work until he's 100, helping the next generation understand we are in this together.
Don't be selfish. You'll be a person that can help others, not only with words, but with deeds. Do something. Don't talk about it.
you do it and be consistent on your cooperation, your conversation, your interaction with your neighbors. So that's my philosophy.
So many inspiring stories. The celebration of Hispanic Heritage Month actually involves 2 months running from September 15th to October 15th. That's because several Latin American countries celebrate their independence the week of September 15th. And then Indigenous Peoples Day and Columbus Day is officially observed in mid-October.
Still ahead, fighting for equality in the farm fields and beyond.
The changes that we want have to be put into legislation where people can be held accountable.
Hispanic activists helping build a better future. Plus,
and that is where our first performances took place, right by the side of the road.
And you're doing this all out of the back of a truck?
Yes.
Roadside performances influencing theater and movies. The cultural impact on everything from the arts to cuisine when Project Community Celebrating Hispanic Heritage returns.
Hispanic Americans have built a legacy of activism and change in our communities, and that change is transforming working conditions in the farm fields, bringing culture and important stories to the stage and silver screen, and creating opportunities to build stronger communities. On the front lines of activism, you'll find Paco Fuentes, a community leader in Nebraska, Luis Valdez, a Hollywood writer and director, and Dolores Huerta, co-founder of the United Farm Workers Union. We begin with her story from reporter Stephanie Muniz.
Dolores Huerta has spent more than 50 years organizing peaceful demonstrations in the U.S., advocating for farm workers, immigrants, and women in the United States. She worked alongside Cesar Chavez, creating the United Farm Workers Union. Her work prompted a consumer grape boycott that eventually led to the Agriculture Relations Act in 1975, which allowed farm workers to bargain for better wages and working conditions. But even with these accomplishments, the outcomes were not always peaceful.
I was badly battered or had my ribs broken, pulverized my spleen, and I almost died for doing peaceful protests.
We are still seeing similar protests today. In the summer of 2020, the Black Lives Matter movement caused a stir throughout the nation. Huerta says the idea of what role police officers have are many times skewed within communities of color.
Now police are looked on not as protectors, they're looked on as predators. And, you know, they do this racial profiling.
She says making sure future generations understand what came before is key to building our future.
We know the contribution of our folks, people from our ethnic group to society. It gives us a feeling of confidence. It gives us a feeling of pride so that we can be proud of who we are.
Huerta says in her case, her pride to be Latina goes back to her roots in New Mexico generations ago with the marriage of her Spaniard great-great-grandfather and a Pueblo Indian woman.
I found out that I have a great-great-great-great 14th generation grandmother named Ines, who was a Pueblo Indian, you know, and I mean, that fills me with so much pride.
She asked people to speak up and continue the fight against racism.
That we have to put these issues, the changes that we want, have to be put into legislation, legislation into a law that can be implemented, okay, that can be enforced, and where people can be held accountable.
To build greater equality in our communities.
Born in Delano, California, in a labor camp, Luis Valdez became interested in theater at 6 years old.
And I told my mom the plays on Friday. She says, I can't help that. We're being evicted. So I was never in the play. And that left the hunger.
a hunger for drama while deeply committed to the United Farm Worker struggle. In 1965, at 25 years old, he joined Cesar Chavez as a volunteer in the Delano grape strike. There, on the picket lines, Valdez El Teatro Campesino, the Farm Workers Theater, was born.
And it was this car caravan that went out in search of scabs in the fields. And then we pulled off by the side of the road whenever we found one. And that's where all of the picketing and the chanting took place. And that is where our first performances took place, right by the side of the road.
And you're doing this all out of the back of a truck?
Yes, we used a lot of humor and a lot of physical comedy.
Valdez used theater to inspire social change. In 1966, members of the theater marched from Delano, California, in Kern County, to Sacramento, California, attracting national media attention.
And so the word got out. All of that led to the evolution of the Teatro Campesino as a theater company, but better yet, it led to the spread of the news that the farm workers were not just docile idiots. We were alive and we were fighting for our human rights for everybody.
Valdez went on to write a play about the 1943 Los Angeles Zoot Suit Riots. The riots were violent clashes in which U.S. servicemen, off-duty police, attacked young Latino and Mexican Americans in L.A. Valdez Zoot Suit became the first play written by a Latino on Broadway and went on to become the first Chicano major feature film in 1981.
The press has distorted the very meaning of the word Zoot Suit. All it is for you guys is another way to say Mexican without insulting your allies south of the border.
Other successes included his box office hit film La Bamba in 1987. He won countless awards, including a Peabody. His scripts are taught in classrooms, performed on high school and college stages. Staying true to his roots, Valdez is still going strong and making a difference at his internationally renowned Obie Award-winning theater in San Juan Bautista.
It's important that our stories be told as honestly as possible. And that there be authentic voices that are speaking from the heart.
When he was only a toddler, Paco Fuentes and his family emigrated from the heartland of Mexico to the heartland of the United States, Omaha, Nebraska. His father, a talented basket weaver, wanted just a bit more for his children.
I had really good friends. I enjoyed school. But you know, I was aware of the differences. You know, I was very aware that we were from Mexico and that we were working class.
Determined to build a life of his own, Fuentes was uplifted by Latino mentors and organizations in South Omaha, a vibrant community filled with immigrants.
I was able again to receive skills, opportunities, mentorship that I probably wouldn't have gotten, you know, if it weren't for them.
And one particular place called the Boys Club became his second home until he was 18.
And I remember just being amazed at all the things that it had. It had pool tables, a swimming pool. We ate for a quarter. I mean, I fell in love. Love at first sight. It was a safe place. And I stayed out of trouble. And so it was a great place to grow up.
Then at 19, Fuentes joined the Air Force, serving his country for over two decades in military intelligence, traveling all over the world. A year after retirement, Fuentes circled back to his first love, the Boys Club, now known as the Boys and Girls Club.
My first 20 years in the military, which includes one war, prepared me for Boys and Girls Club.
With a neglected building, a revolving door of directors, the club needed some TLC.
And from the very beginning, I felt that we could be a world-class organization.
Fuentes took charge, pushing kids towards academic success, helping young men escape gang life, and bringing the community a bit closer together.
It was just a wonderful ride, but it was a lot of work.
Only 5 years as director, his club was ranked in the top 25 around the globe. The following year, the once modest program earned an award as the best. But for Fuentes, the awards were not the rewards.
So the biggest testament was when my kids, my club kids, left, had families, and would bring their kids back. That's probably the biggest compliment. Hey, I grew up here. This was good enough for me. This is good enough for my kids. I've decided to dedicate my life to closing the gap between the haves and the have-nots.
Next, as we celebrate Hispanic heritage, different styles of music, colorful costumes. And every dance tells a different story, the history and tradition of baile folklorico.
People come to America to make their dreams become real life, and those who are finding success are trying to spread their culture to educate future generations and encourage unity. Through the movements of Sacramento's Baile Folklorico Nube de Oro to two brothers finding their way in the food industry. Here are reporters Maricela de la Cruz and Chris Martinez.
Nestled on a corner near bustling Clematis Street in downtown West Palm Beach, is a taste of Mexican flavor.
What does Rivales mean?
Rivales is it's a rivalry, and it's also a combination of our last names. We have different last names. My last name is Rivas, and his name is Valdivia, so together we put that together. Constant tacos coming out of here. Beans are being made right now. We have corn in the back. We prep everything around here. Boom, boom, boom.
Jimmy Rivas and his brother Alberto Valdivia were born in Nicaragua.
Opportunity of, you know, growing and, you know, being successful, that no longer existed in the country. You no longer own your properties. You no longer, you know, have a say. Everything, you know, is controlled by the government.
Gunfire, we used to have sandbags in front of our homes because my dad went against the government, so they were gonna trying to kill him. So he came first and then he sent for all of us after.
They escaped, catching a flight to Guatemala, boarding a bus to the Mexican border, then crossing the Rio Grande into Texas. They were picked up by immigration, documented, and sent to Miami.
We spent a few days in the streets because we didn't have nowhere to go. That's when a Cuban family was able to support us, found us, and gave us a place to stay.
All right, chicken bowl, no tomato. I waited tables and worked construction. I worked two jobs, saved up as much money as I could. Alongside my brother did the same thing. We both worked really hard. And we took a risk with very little money.
We're cooking, you know, our pork, slow roasting our pork. We're making our fresh bread.
The brothers' business ventures are far from finished. They recently opened a second restaurant, Cortadito Cuban Cafe.
I feel like that food has so much flavor, and I think when you do it authentic and you do it the way it's supposed to be done, it's very important. That way you can have people that are not from those parts of the world appreciate it, and people that do know it appreciate it as well.
Every step bringing Baile Folklorico to life.
Dancing folklorico, it's a very interesting way of teaching your body how to move.
Every dance telling the stories of people, their lives, and culture.
There's different styles of music. Some of it is very lively, very energetic, very fast. Some of it is really slow. And that all depends on the traditions. It will depend on the Mexican state where the music is coming from, and then also specific to our region.
Osvaldo Ramirez Vidales has been dancing and teaching Baile Folklorico for more than 20 years. The traditional dancing dating back centuries.
But in Mexican Folklorico, we're combining various styles of dance that were adopted since the colonization of the Americas. So European dances, African dances, Asian dances, and styles kind of converged and created what Mexican Folklorico is nowadays.
With vibrant colors that fill up stages, each state and region have costumes that depict their history.
There is also a huge variety of costumes. Oftentimes we just think like, oh, there might be just one costume per state.
Giving an opportunity to some dancers to reconnect with their culture.
There is a certain amount of dancers that join because they have actually never been to Mexico. They were born and raised here in the United States or even in other countries, and then they join because this is part of their heritage.
And a way for others to learn as dancing resumes.
All of our dance performances and events can cancel for so long, there is a need. There's like an interest. People are hungry to see dances.
Maricela de la Cruz, KCRA 3 News.
Thank you, everyone, for making it tonight. Awesome job, everyone.
Thank you. They are so talented. You can find more inspiring stories in the Project Community section of our app. I'm Lisa Gonzalez. Thank you for joining us to celebrate Hispanic Heritage.